This video is sponsored by me and Learn Light and Sound. We have courses on how to improve your lighting and sound for video, links down below. 32-bit float sound recording, is it magic and how does it work? First, is it magic? Short answer, no it is not. All right, so how does it work? 32-bit float seemingly allows you to recover recorded sound which goes above 0 dB after the recording when you're in post-production. Normally with 24-bit recording, anything above 0 dB is distorted and you can't really fix it in post. 32-bit float can be helpful in a few situations. For example, dialogue sound. If you push your gain setting too high while recording with 32-bit float, you're less likely to ruin your recording because in most cases you can actually reduce the overall levels in post-production and the audio will come back. It won't be distorted. So that's really, really nice. It can also be helpful for sound effects, but it's not unclippable like some people and some manufacturers suggest, so that's really important to keep in mind. And this is especially true with the budget-oriented gear, so I don't want to call anyone out, but the reality is that some of the less expensive recorders, you can still very much clip, especially with the included microphones, say for example with a Zoom F2 or something like that. And even with a really high-quality 32-bit float recorder, if your microphone can't handle an audio signal that's really, really loud that you're recording, it's still going to distort. So you have to keep in mind that the piece of equipment in your overall audio kit that has the least dynamic range, the least ability to record loud to soft sounds, that's going to be how much dynamic range total that you can record. So if you're using a kind of not very great microphone, well, even with a great recorder, it's not going to be able to record a ton of dynamic range, really, really loud sounds to really, really quiet, soft whispers. So here, for example, if you're using a Sound Devices 32-bit float recorder with 142 decibels of dynamic range, your microphone can still distort if you try to record a sound that is louder than the mic can handle. And your 32-bit float recorder cannot compensate for your microphone's problems or issues or limitations. So I'm really sorry to rain on your 32-bit float parade, but I'm here to give you some tough love, and that is to say that you're better off knowing how this works than going around with unrealistic expectations. So let's talk about it a little bit. Incidentally, did you know that 24-bit recordings can handle up to 144 decibels of dynamic range, which is more than a 32-bit float Sound Devices Mix pre-recorder handles, incidentally? So the question is, there are a couple questions. Why do we even bother with 32-bit float recording? And secondly, what kind of sounds are people recording that require that much dynamic range? It's certainly not spoken word audio. So let's start here. What is dynamic range? So dynamic range is the difference between the loudest sound that a device can capture without distorting and the quietest sound it can capture just above the noise floor that that device creates. And by noise floor, I mean self-noise that the product itself is generating, not noise in a room. So the difference between the loudest sound it can record and essentially the quietest sound it can record. That's dynamic range. Now, what kinds of things actually need 140 decibels of dynamic range? Again, not spoken word audio. Most conversations are between 40 and 60 decibels SPL. So that's a range of 20 dB. And if you add in laughs and screams and things like that, maybe you're looking at a dynamic range of 60, maybe 70 dB. So well under 100 decibels. So why do we bother with 32-bit float recording at all? And here's why, I think. The tangible benefit of 32-bit float audio recording of spoken word, and I'm speaking here specifically about talking, spoken word audio, the tangible benefit that I see is that if you set the gain too high during your recording, you can reduce the gain in post-production, and you can probably recover it without distortion in most cases. So that's the benefit, but here's the trick. On most 32-bit float recorders, you don't actually set the preamplifier's gain in 32-bit float mode. We'll come back to that in just a minute. So how does 32-bit float recording of audio work? 32-bit float is actually, let me start here, is a bad name for this technology because that only describes one part of the overall technology. There are actually three things that a 32-bit float recorder needs to be, the right word is escaping me, but it to be better than a 24-bit recorder, and that's actually not the right way to say it, to effectively do what it claims it can do, which is recover the sound that goes above 0 dB in post-production. So it needs three things to do that. Number one, it needs an analog preamplifier stage that can capture a wide dynamic range. And part of, again, that dynamic range is that it has to have very, very low self-noise because, again, remember, it's the range from the highest sounds it can possibly record without distorting down to the quietest sounds it can record above the device's noise floor. So it has to have very, very little self-noise. Now, here's an example. The Sound Devices Mix Pre and the Sound Devices 800 series recorders, their specification says that they can record up to 142 decibels of dynamic range, which is actually quite impressive. The Zoom F8N Pro claims a dynamic range of 113 decibels, just for reference. And again, remember, we talked about regular conversations between people, normally ranging between about 20 dB, possibly going, you know, if there are loud screams or something like that, up to maybe 60 or 70 dB. So you can easily fit that within these preamplifiers. Second thing that a 32-bit float recorder needs is it needs an analog-to-digital conversion circuit or stage or whatever you want to call it that can handle all the dynamic range that that preamplifier can give it. So the way they're typically doing this on 32-bit float recorders is they're using multiple analog-to-digital converters. Sometimes two, sometimes even more than that. So what each converter is doing is it's taking a portion of the amplitude of that audio and it's doing the conversion of that part, and another converter is taking maybe the quiet parts and taking care of that. And then finally, it needs the ability to record all of that dynamic range that has been converted to digital into a file container that can handle all that dynamic range. And here's where it gets a little bit less clear to me. In many cases, you should be able to do that in a 24-bit container, but the reality is with 24-bit, once you get to the lower levels, the gap between each level gets bigger and bigger, and so there can be quantization errors. And if you don't understand what any of this means, don't worry about it. I think that's why they're using 32-bit float containers, is you have a much larger range to work with, so you're not going to run into those quantization errors as easily. So whichever of these three things has the lowest or the most limited dynamic range defines what your overall recording kit can record in terms of dynamic range. In other words, from the quietest things to the loudest things. So, for example, the total supported dynamic range of the Sound Devices Mix Pre 2 series recorders is 142 dB. How do we know? Well, the specs tell us. Let's just assume that they're right on that. Number two, the multi-stage analog to digital converters could probably handle actually more than this, but Sound Devices don't really give us that specification, so we're just going to assume that it can cover the same 142 dB that the preamplifier can. And then it can record to 32-bit float. So that's how you get the overall dynamic range that this recorder can handle, which is 142 dB overall. But here's the reality. As soon as you connect a microphone to that, the microphone most likely becomes the limiting factor in how much dynamic range you can record. And this becomes especially an important consideration when you're talking about recording really loud sound effects. So that's where 32-bit float may not be able to save you. Under most circumstances for spoken word, dialogue, even screaming, it's probably going to be able to handle it. But here's the thing. Even the most pro-level mics probably can't handle 142 dB of dynamic range. And if we're talking about most wireless microphone systems, they typically can handle even less than that. And if you're talking about consumer wireless systems, it's probably even less than that. And now some of you are going to probably be saying, Curtis, what about the Rode Wireless Pro that can record 32-bit float to its transmitter, or the DJI Mic 2? Well, yeah, on the transmitter they can do that, but as soon as they transmit wirelessly, you're probably losing a lot of dynamic range right in there. So that's something important to keep in mind. And your recorder cannot compensate for limited dynamic range upstream from the recorder. It can't fix a low dynamic range microphone or a low dynamic range wireless microphone system. So, all right. Now, one practical matter here to keep in mind, even though many of us think that 32-bit float recording is really neat, there is a trade-off. Anytime your audio goes above 0 dB while you're recording, you have to fix that in post. So, yeah, you don't have to use a limiter or you don't have to live with distorted audio, but you do have to, you're moving that work to post-production. So if you think it's going to just reduce your overall work, it may not be the case. It actually is, you're still going to have to do that work at some point. Also, 32-bit float is basically useless in live sound. So if you're doing any sort of live show, a live stream, for example, 32-bit float is not going to help you. You still have to manage that because when you send the audio and the video to the streaming platform, it's 24-bit. It just is. And so even if you were able to record and send 32-bit float on a live stream, on the user's end, their device can only play back 24-bit. Because if it is 32-bit float and it goes above zero, any speaker, doesn't matter what kind of speaker it is going to distort when you're talking about greater than 0 dB full scale. So they're just a lot of things. So overall, you can see 32-bit float is not magical. It's just some clever engineering. And when you're just recording spoken word sound, in most cases, you don't really have to stress whether you set your gain too high. And that's a nice feature for those of us maybe who run a production all by ourselves. We are doing camera, we're doing lighting, we're doing the interview, we're recording sound, we're providing the craft services and feeding these people who we're interviewing on camera. In those cases, it can be helpful. You've got a lot going on and you might mess things up. You might not set the gain optimally. So this is where it can be a useful thing. Now, it can also be useful in unscripted video where you don't know what people are going to say. You don't know if they're going to scream or laugh really loudly at some point, and it can help you in those circumstances as well. Now, to kind of sum that all up, when recording spoken word audio, pretty much the only problem that 32-bit float solves for you is that you don't have to worry about gain too much. You can fix it in post if you have to, but as a recordist of audio, you still have to position the microphone correctly. You still have to deal with lavalier microphones picking up clothing rustle. You still have to deal with radio frequency issues like dropouts or interference if you're using wireless microphones. You have to manage noise in the recording space. You have to use a microphone that doesn't generate a ton of self-noise and that has a sufficient dynamic range. You have to make sure your post team knows what to do with 32-bit float audio if you are handing the audio off to a post team. And it's not just yourself working on it. You have to solve all the problems that can and do arise when trying to record quality audio. So 32-bit float does not solve all of the world's problems when it comes to recording audio. I just want everyone to understand that. Some people get all excited and say, it's a game changer. And yeah, and that one aspect where you can actually pull things back down below 0 dB in post if you need to when you're recording spoken word audio. Yeah, I suppose it is if you're using quality gear, like quality microphones along with your recorder. But it doesn't solve all these other problems, and it doesn't take away the job of sound engineers. Now, big question, how do you set gain on 32-bit float recorders? That's a trick question, because gain is actually set by the engineers who designed the recorder, and you can't change it. Presumably, they set the gain quite low, at a level where the recorded audio sits well above the noise floor, but where there's still lots of room, lots of headroom for things to get louder without distorting. So, for example, on the mixed pre-recorders, when it says gain, that's actually not preamplifier gain. What that is that's taking the audio after it goes through the preamplifier at the gain level set by the engineers. It then gets converted to digital. And then when you turn that gain up from there, it's just boosting those levels digitally. That's all it's doing. So that's how it's different when you're working with a 32-bit float recorder in 32-bit float mode. So how do you set gain? Well, you just set it like you normally would. You set the gain or the fader on your 32-bit float recorder the same way you would for a 24-bit recording. You set the gain so that your meters peak at a healthy level, somewhere around minus 18 dB is what I usually aim for. If you do that, that'll allow you to monitor the sound comfortably. And I can't tell you how many people have bought Zoom F3s and said, Curtis, I can't hear anything while it's recording. Well, set the level higher, and that's just essentially turning the fader up so that you can monitor the sound comfortably. It also allows you to send a mix to your camera. It's a level that your camera can work with. It also allows you to send a wireless feed to crew members if you're working on a crew where you need to send a wireless feed from your recorder to one of them. So that's how it works. Now, when you've set this gain, and if you're lucky, the post team won't have to fix any issues where the audio exceeds 0 dB. But if the audio does go above 0 dB, they can probably fix it if you're talking about, again, spoken word audio. So again, the only exclusion would be if your microphone can't handle the sound pressure levels, the loudness of what it's trying to record, and usually with spoken word audio, they can. So that's what you need to keep in mind. Now, you're probably sensing a theme here, and that theme is you need to use a good microphone if you really want to record a wide dynamic range, especially when you're working with sound effects that could get very, very, very loud. So think jet engines and things like that. So what's a good enough microphone? Well, let's look at a few pro models and understand what their dynamic range is, just so that we have a sense. DPA 4017B shotgun microphone has a dynamic range of 124 dB. That's substantially less than a Sound Devices Mix Pre 2 series. The Schoeps CMC641, and microphone that is used on so many films and TV shows, 117 dB. Sennheiser MKH50, also a microphone that's used on a ton of shows, 122 dB. And the Sennheiser MKH416 shotgun microphone, 117 decibels of dynamic range. So that's usually going to be your limiting factor. And again, for spoken word audio, 117 dB is plenty to capture audio from a spoken word context. Even if somebody screams, it can probably still handle that. And then your 32-bit float recorder can capture all 117 dB of that microphone. So in summary, if you use a quality microphone that can handle more than, let's say, 110 dB of dynamic range and a quality 32-bit float recorder, maybe a Sound Devices Mix Pre, a Sound Devices 800 series, a Zoom F8M Pro, if you use one of those, you don't have to worry a lot about setting your gain too high for recordings of spoken word audio. However, be careful when you're recording sound effects that could get very, very, very loud. You're going to need to be a little bit more careful. You're going to need to look at what your equipment is capable of, and particularly your microphone. Look, for example, as a start, at the max SPL level that that microphone is capable of handling. The higher, the better. And so it should also have a good bit of dynamic range. Also, if you're handing your audio recordings off to a post-production team, talk to them first. Not all of those teams want 32-bit float audio. And a lot of them are not really set up in terms of their workflow to handle that. It's their digital audio workstation in 2024 can probably handle it, but that may not be how they're working. And they have templates set up and projects that are set up at 24-bit. They may not have the time to adapt to a 32-bit float workflow. So make sure you talk to them first before you give it to them. Otherwise, it'll probably be your job to take all that 32-bit float audio and convert it to 24-bit before handing it off. So I hope that helps you understand 32-bit float a little bit better, how it works, what problems it solves, what problems it doesn't solve, how it isn't changing the world and bringing world peace, unfortunately. But hopefully that's helpful to understand. Get out there and make some great sound. Talk to you again soon.